This is a public meeting. Any person wishing to address the city council, Cesar agency to the redevelopment agency and the housing authority is asked to complete a blue speaker slip and submit it to the city clerk prior to the start of the meeting. When the item is announced and your name is called by the mayor, please come forward to the microphone and address yourself. Address yourself to the city council. Unless the mayor extends the time, there is a 3-minute time limit for each public presentation. If you wish to address the city council on any subject matter within the city's council's jurisdiction that is not listed on the agenda, you may do so during the public comment portion of the agenda. Any information provided on the speaker slip will be public record. Open session. This is call this meeting to order of the city council, also serving as assessor agency to the redevelopment agency and assessor to the housing agency. Diane, could you please do the roll call?
Councilmember Sanders?
Here.
Councilmember Jackson? Excused. Councilmember Silva?
Present.
Councilmember Villegas Walker?
Here.
And Mayor Solomon?
Here. We'll have the pledge of allegiance by Mr. Silva and invocation by Mrs. Walker.
Please join me in saluting our flag. Ready to begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing and bow your heads. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity for us to come together as leaders in the community. Help us to exercise good judgment and always be mindful of the faith and trust placed in us by this community. Help us to absolutely be living lives of gratitude for all of the many blessings that are bestowed upon us. These things we pray in thy humble name. Amen.
We have the city attorney's report.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. On a motion by Councilmember Villegas Walker, second by Councilmember Silva, the City Council met in closed session at 11:33 a.m. Councilmembers Solomon, Villegas Walker, and Sanders were present, and Councilmember Silva arrived at 11:35 a.m. Councilmember Jackson was absent. Council met with its labor relations negotiators, Ruben Duran, city manager, and Terry Brownlee, human resources director, concerning labor matters with all of the individuals and groups listed on the city council agenda. There is no action to report with respect to Firefighters Association, but direction was given to staff. There are agreements with all the other individuals and groups listed on the city council agenda coming out of closed session for approval, and there are no other matters to report on labor negotiations. Okay. City Council met with its real property negotiators, Ruben Duran, City Manager, Marcela Piedra, Economic Development Director, and Norma Villacana, Community Development Director, and heard a report regarding the lease and purchase negotiations for the property located at 609 North Imperial Avenue. Direction was given to staff with no action to report. Closed session concluded at 12:21 p.m., and that concludes my report, Mr. Mayor.
Okay.
Yeah.
Schedule public comments. Not to exceed 3 minutes each. Items appearing under this section have submitted a written request to the city clerk a minimum of 1 week prior to the regular meeting. I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Silva right now.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. It's really my pleasure to introduce to the council and to the community, for those of you that may not know him, Edwin Overkfell. If you read the newspaper a couple of weeks or so ago, we saw a really good article on the retirement of our current ROP superintendent, Mrs. Mary Camacho, after 37 years of service to our children and our community, I think 18 of them being the ROP superintendent. And we've all seen presentations made here by a number of their projects, and we always have been very impressed and on the work that's done by ROP and their employees under the leadership of Mrs. Camacho. It is my pleasure to introduce to you Edwin Overfell, who has already accepted the position as the interim superintendent for ROP effective July 1. And we all know that he's got some really big shoes to fill. Edwin is a local product, the product of our local schools. I've known Edwin for over 20 years, so I'm very happy to introduce you to him and also give you my sense that he will do just as good a job. He's got tremendous roots in our community, business person, ROP employee. I'm stealing some of your presentation, I'm sure, Edwin, but I'm just very happy that the ROP board chose wisely and finding a replacement for Mary Camacho. I know she's hard to replace, but I wanted to make sure that the community began to know you. So do you want to say a few words?
Yes, thank you very much for allowing me the opportunity to introduce myself. Again, my name is Edwin Nobergfell, and I'm the interim superintendent for IVROP effective July the 1st. And it is very hard to follow a legend. Mary is, over, as Efrain pointed out, over 37 years of service, 18 of those years with IVROP. Just millions and millions of dollars worth of grant money that was brought to this county and to the city of El Centro through her hard work and through her dedication. So I definitely am following a legend here, and I have some really big shoes to fill. But a little bit about myself, as Efrain pointed out, I am currently the project director and assistant superintendent for IVROP. I have over 22 years of experience in workforce and economic development, 9 of those years with the Employment Development Department here locally, and 13 years with IVROP. With my IVROP career, I've been a school-to-career coordinator to my present position, Project Juntos coordinator and assistant superintendent, where we were honored earlier this year by when the mayor attended our Healthy Marriage Conference Week during National Healthy Marriage Week at the Eagles Lodge. I have been the assistant superintendent for the past year, as I've mentioned. I also had, as Efrain pointed out, I've been very blessed and thankful to my wife, who between us, we've owned janitorial services for over 17 years, and certainly we have, between my wife and myself, we have the knowledge of what it runs to take a small business in Imperial County and what it is to be a job seeker as well. Some of the grants that I've written and some of the grants that I've assisted on and I've managed is Project Hope, which was one of the first ones where we actually helped what at the time was Brawley Beef, now National Beef, do some training and help them actually be placed in the city of Brawley. I worked on the first Serve Vets grant. Actually wrote that, Faces to the Future program, Project Uno and One, which is an RN mentorship program, and the current Juntos program, to name a few. Several of the programs that I've managed have also been recognized as best practice model programs, to the effect that we've been fortunate to help some of our peers in San Antonio, Texas, not too long ago, to talk to them about how we run our program. And as a matter of fact, we're going to be visited by our Hawaiian counterparts. So to come to Hawaii, to El Centro during the summer, I explained to them what our weather's like. And this is certainly not San Diego, which I don't know if they're expecting that, the San Diego weather. But they're going to be coming over here to review and do a site visit of our program as well. We've also been asked to present at the national level for a number of conferences. As Efrain pointed out, I'm a lifelong county resident, with the exception of going to San Diego State main campus. And also, I was privileged and honored to be selected to be the representative for EDD and Trade and Commerce in Sacramento for a period there, where I was a representative for EDD and Trade and Commerce for 30 counties. I'm bilingual and bicultural. I hablo muy bien el español. Mi mamá fue maestra en México, entonces sé y domino el español muy bien. I'm currently a project coordinator and the assistant superintendent. A little bit about my background. I co-own with my wife Service Master by Obergfell Janitorial Services, and I worked at EDD. My education consists of, I recently completed the Superintendent Academy from the Association of California School Administrators. I have a master's degree in business administration from the University of Phoenix. I have my Bachelor of Arts in Political Science major and Public Administration minor from San Diego State University. I'm also a volunteer and hope to be a board member soon of the IVROP Community Foundation. I actually got to write, Mary asked me, after we priced the attorneys, local attorneys, and we saw it was going to be a bit more money than what we had in the foundation-wise to create the 501c3, she asked me to write it, and I was fortunate to be able to write it, and with the help help of her sister, Sherry Newell, who is also an attorney. She kind of reviewed it, and we got that going. But anyway, the IVROP, as you probably know, Dancing with the Stars is our biggest fundraiser event, and we also just recently have given out over $30,000 worth of scholarships, and over 19,000 scholarships, dollars worth of scholarships to 30 students, which Mr. Silva, of course, is a board member. I am a member of the California Association of Regional Occupational Centers. And I'm a member of the Association of California School Administrators. I'm a member of the National Federation of Independent Businesses, member of the Imperial Valley Employer Advisory Council, the U.S. Green Council, the California Chamber of Commerce, San Diego State Alumni Association, lifetime member, University of Phoenix. I'm also a member of our church, and serve as a finance counsel, and I'm also a member of the Lectern Eucharistic Minister. I'm blessed to have married to my lovely wife for over 28 years. My daughter currently works at EDD. She's the Employment Program Manager here in Imperial County. She's Dania Obergfell-Luna. My other daughter, Jenna Lee, just graduated with a master's degree program from USC. She would hate that if I would say USC. Yes, she would hate that. From UCLA School of Planning, so I'm very proud of her. And my son just graduated as a computer science engineer from San Diego State. Some of our goals, immediate goals for IVROP, is to continue to prepare our youth and adults to be career ready, to be technically skilled, and academically prepared through our already career technical effective program that we have. The other thing that we want to do is strengthen the relationships that we have with our partner organizations such as the cities, but we also want to strengthen that relationship with the districts that we serve. We want to continue to seek and obtain new grants. We know that that is, as you probably know, 80% of our funding comes through grants, so we will continue to actively pursue those. And I am blessed to have it to be able to inherit a great staff. So IVROP will continue to work, and we continue to strive working with you. And again, I appreciate the time to be here and to introduce myself and to let you know that I am at your service and ready to be helped out in any way, shape, or form. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
thanks. We have a presentation by Friends of the Library regarding donations to the library.
Honorable Mayor and other members of the City Council, my name is Rose Banks, and we are so happy to be here to announce that we have some money and funds to donate to the library. This is Maria Martinez. She is one of our recruiters. Unfortunately, my vice president and my secretary are on vacation, and our other member is home ill in bed, so we will be doing the whole thing ourselves. We don't have one check, but we have two checks to present to the Friends of the Library. This is a small association run mostly by grandmothers with grandchildren who want their children to read. We receive donations of books, and we sort them, and then we clean them, sell them, and return the funds to the library. We have a check tonight to give two checks. The first one is one for $1,300 to help with the summer school program. The second one is one for $1,000 to buy a rug for the children's area where they hold the children's area in the library. So Ms. Martinez will make the presentation of the checks tonight.
Mr. Banks, he will introduce you. This check paid to the Order for the Central Public Library. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Mrs. Garcia.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Council Members. Yvette Garcia with the Child Abuse Prevention Council of Imperial County, Executive Director. I would like to extend an invitation to Mr. Mayor and all the Council Members to attend our annual annual meeting and recognitions dinner on June 26th, next Wednesday, at the American Legion. At that time, we'll be recognizing several community members of their outstanding efforts to support not only the CAP Council, but also the community in general. The dinner will be a tri-tip dinner served by the American Legion, so we're working together, helping nonprofits out together. And at that time, we would also like to award to the city a plaque in our appreciation and recognition of all the support that you've given the Child Abuse Prevention Council and in our futures for grants and so forth. Other distinguished guests that will be recognized that evening will be Alex Cardenas from CASA, for his outstanding efforts in our community. Lana Cervantes, agent with State Farm, also a beautiful community member. Bert Holt with the Church of Latter-day Saints for all of his work that he's always out there helping us at the Children's Fair at the church. Alma Guzman, who is a volunteer now, working part-time in our office, but was a volunteer in our office, who volunteered over 140 hours of parent education to our parents that we serve. Another person is Jocelyn Mendez. She's a 10-year-old from Raleigh who had a lemonade stand a few weeks ago and raised $28 from her lemonade stand and donated that to the CAP Council for us to buy some materials we needed for our child care room. The other things that we'll be covering, we will have a short presentation by Peter DeMonto on building functional families, and we will have our year-end report of all the activities the CAP Council has done and what we hold for the future. So again, I extend my invitation to all of you to please attend our, and I have an invitation here, to please attend our dinner if possible, and I have a representative there to accept the award.
And you said that's at the American Legion Hall?
American Legion, June 26th from 6 to 9.
Well, put it in my calendar.
There we go.
And it is a Aloha Summer Luau, so wear your beautiful Hawaiian attire. We hope to make it fun and have everyone there for a nice summer break to enjoy the evening with all of our volunteers and our community members. So thank you.
Thank you.
Consent agenda. Consent agenda items are approved by one motion. Council members or members of the public may pull consent items to be considered separately at a time determined by the mayor. I know that item 10 has been pulled by Mrs. Walker. Is there anyone else?
Mr. Mayor, I move for item 6 through 9 and then item number 11 for approval.
I think 3 through 9.
I'm sorry, 3 through, thank you very much, 3 through 9 and then item number 11.
I'll second that.
We have a motion by Mrs. Sanders, a second by Mrs. Walker. Please vote.
Motion carries 4-0.
Ms. Walker.
Yes, I had asked that item number 10 be pulled so we could get additional information with regard to the timing of the Imperial Avenue Rehabilitation Project. People are going to be really excited about this moving forward. And so, Mr. Hagan, if we could please get a little bit of additional information.
Sure. This is the project schedule up there. It's a very tight schedule, so we're going to move forward quickly and hopefully have the project complete by the end of November.
Awesome. Very, very, very cool. So the next advertising starts, open bids, 20 days. Okay, so council awarding of bids August 6th.
Yes.
There is an item on the agenda to go dark in August, but I guess we could have a special meeting to...
Well, we would hold a regular meeting, but like at noon for one item.
Perfect.
And this, the reason for the need to have it adopted has to do with, this is a grant fund, and we're coming up on, there was a deadline that was changed by the state, so we had to accelerate this several months.
That's correct.
Okay, and just for the benefit of the folks in the audience, Mr. Hagan, it's rehabilitation of Imperial Avenue from Interstate 8 to Orange Avenue.
Yes, those are just the, go ahead, Terry, why don't you walk
yes,
through that?
Yes, it's from Ocotillo to Orange on the northbound.
Right.
And then we're adding a new left turn at Pepper, so northbound traffic will be able to make a left turn there. This is the existing island, and this is the proposed left turn lane there.
So that'll give us a smooth ride all the way throughout Imperial Avenue?
Northbound.
Northbound.
Northbound only, okay.
Now, after the first of the year, we'll have another project that we'll do southbound, but we'll be installing a sewer line, so it'll be a fairly lengthy project. And as they install the sewer line, new paving will be on the southbound lanes.
Okay. Could we also, under best case scenario, get a timeline like you showed with the first slide for the other half of the project? And recognizing it's a ways out, but
right,
so yeah, we can understand how the two projects.
We can send that as an informational item to you, Terry. Just staying on a schedule.
Yes.
That would be perfect. I did want to comment. I did receive a call from an El Centro resident concerned about the lack of maintenance of the landscaping right outside the hospital there on Imperial Avenue, if we could have.
Well, that, one of the, we looked at that with parks and streets, and because this project is coming on so quickly, rather than trying to start that up, that will follow with this project, because we're going to be tearing up that whole area. We're not going to be able to get to it. That's where that's recognized as a project, and we're going to time that rehabilitation with this project.
Okay, let's make sure that we have that communication piece included, and that way everyone will know that great things are coming.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
With that, I'd like to move approval, Mr. Mayor, of item number 10.
Second.
We have a motion by Mrs. Walker, second by Mr. Silva. Please vote.
Motion carries 4 with 1 absent.
Okay. Public hearing. The public hearing for the purpose of considering the following application for property located at the northeast corner of Crookshank Drive and Waterman Avenue, further identified by APN 064-442-001. General Plan Amendment Number 12-03 and amendments from the General Commercial to High Medium Density Residence and Negative Declaration Number 12-05A has been prepared and will also be considered. Change of Zone Number 12-03, a change of zone from CG General Commercial to R3 Multiple Family Residence and Negative Declaration Number 12-05B has been prepared and will also be considered. Norma Liocane, IAICP.
Thank you. Good evening, Honorable Mayor and members of the Council. As mentioned, this is a request that was submitted by AMG and Associates. What they're proposing to do is they're requesting that a change of zone, a general plan amendment and a change of zone be approved for this property located on the northeast corner of Waterman Avenue and Crookshank Drive. The property is approximately 4.33 acres. It's vacant right now. It's located in the general commercial zone, and it's considered to be lot 14 of the previously approved Northgate subdivision, if you recall, a few years back. This is the location map. Again, this is the vacant property. You have Food for Less and the other the shopping center in this site, and you have El Centro Motors to the north. This is just part of the map that was approved under the Northgate Plaza a few years back. Again, this is the center, and this is this is the parcel that we're referring to, the Food for Less parking area, El Centro Motors, and another vacant parcel to the north. This is just an aerial view. Again, this is the city of Imperial, and this is the vacant property. I'm sorry, this is the vacant property and the aerial. The existing land use at this point is general commercial. The proposed use is high medium density residential. At this time, there is no project proposed. However, the applicant has advised us that the desire is to propose a multifamily residential project in the near future. And the zone is general commercial, as I mentioned, and R3. As far as the environmental review for the project, a traffic study was completed for the project, and after completion of the focus traffic study, the results were that there were no significant impacts related to traffic. Therefore, at this time, we are proposing to a negative declaration for the project. Now, again, there is no project at this time, but at the time there is a project, a site plan review application must be submitted to the city. The size of the parcel allows for about 108 units at full density. Also, the project would be required to have open space amenities, landscaping, bicycle racks, and also to indicate how the interior circulation is being proposed. At this time, we're asking that the public hearing be opened and for the City Council to approve the general plan amendment and change of zone, along with the negative declaration for the project. And this concludes my report.
Okay. Bring it up to the council first.
Ms. Buchanan, is the applicant present?
I had a quick question. When the application was submitted April 2nd, it was indicated that the financial institution or bank providing funding for the project was unknown at this time. Has FI been?
That's still the same. It's still the same this time, yeah. We don't actually have a financing plan that's in place for the project. We're not really sure if it's going to be a senior project or a family project, but we're still looking at financing options.
Okay. For the benefit of the city...
Cameron Johnson, AMG & Associates.
So I just have two comments. One is if we could track to see when that is resolved. I work for a bank. We just need to make sure that there's no conflict that develops down the line. And secondly, to let you know that multifamily residential housing is huge. I mean, this would serve a ginormous need that we currently have in the city. So I hope that you do move forward with the project, and the city will do all we can to assist.
Understood, and we appreciate that. We actually, we probably have about 400 units that we built in the Imperial Valley. We own the El Centro Senior Apartments on Adams.
Yes.
And ultimately, we would love to get off the ground with the project as soon as possible.
Awesome.
I mean, we're exploring financing options daily. So
great.
As soon as we can get something submitted, we'll be back at the city.
Wonderful.
So,
thank you.
Sir, I have a question. Norma, do you see any planning issues in regards to an R3 island surrounded by general commercial uses all the way around?
No. In fact, I think this is a positive move there, because if you see there's commercial, if it's multifamily residential or senior units, it's within walking distance to a grocery store, within walking distance to a bank. So all the amenities are nearby. So that's the perfect location for such a project.
Mm-hmm. All of this mixed use type residential with commercial is really what we're anticipating. More and more people will be looking for, so that they're not having to have cars,
right,
that
yes.
Their mobility is right there, the amenities are right there. Mm-hmm. So it's very exciting.
Mr. Mayor, I have a question, if I may. To piggyback a little bit on the previous two speakers, Mr. Silva and Ms. Walker, but I found it a little strange that you had a negative impact for traffic. For multifamily, I just think that with the number of stores there, traffic is quite heavy already. And then we're putting in this, if it was a senior complex, I could see, but multifamily, I'm not quite so sure.
The negative impact, what happened was when the traffic study was completed, there was a comparison between general commercial and multifamily residential. So basically, general commercial creates more traffic than multifamily residential. That's one of the points. One of the points that did come out of the traffic study, and I don't think I have is a signal light, and this has been proposed in the past with the North Cape Plaza, right along Cottonwood, right here. Okay. However, due to the proximity of Imperial Avenue, Highway 86, that's not possible. So at that time, what we are proposing, that at the time, we don't know how many units are gonna come in. We're gonna have to reevaluate, and maybe instead of a traffic light, what was recommended was maybe having just an island, no left turn, no right turn going to the east. So those are the things that will be considered. But yes, the original North Gate Plaza basically recommended a traffic light at Cottonwood.
So once the project is actually identified whether it's going to be a multifamily or a senior, mm-hmm. and the built-out, he said he was thinking of perhaps 108 units.
The maximum built-out is 108 units, yes. If they go below that density, it could be less. Okay. Now, once we have a site plan review and it's reviewed by the city, obviously we're going to recommend access points, not necessarily off of Crookshank, you know, off of, you know, either Waterman or Ford Drive. So those are the things that we're going to be evaluating with the site plan review.
All right.
No, can you put the aerial back?
Yes. By the way. Oh, this one?
Mm-hmm. Does Waterman extend all the way across the property line?
Yes, all the way to Ford.
All the way to Ford?
Yeah, right here.
Okay, I've never driven it that long.
Yeah, it's just, we just punched it through.
Okay, all right, okay.
And then the canal, the city limits are just north of El Centro Motors.
Okay, right.
And if you recall, there's apartment units right across in the city of Imperial, right to the north.
Is Waterman fully improved, the sidewalk, curb and gutter?
Not along the, it's fully improved on Crookshank, but not on Waterman. So that would be required of the project.
Yeah. Would the improvement be on both sides of Waterman or just on the
property? Project would be required, their just their frontage. Mm-hmm.
And you said earlier that there's a study that would maybe call for a signal light on where?
On Cottonwood. Let's see. Right here. The original study, traffic study that was done when the Northgate Plaza came in was a traffic light on Cottonwood. However, due to the proximity of Highway 86, that's not possible. So what we have right now, we just have a little island.
Right.
And that island allows circulation both to the east and to the west. It may require us to limit the turns, to the left-hand turns coming off of Cottonwood. In other words, it would have to be a right turn. And that's a recommendation that was position with the traffic study. However, again, since we don't know how the circulation or how many units at this time, we're not able to condition the project.
Yeah, but that's not a bad idea because that is the line of sight there coming off of Cottonwood.
Yes.
is not very good. Mm.
But I do think you get a lot of traffic. That's right next to Chase Bank, right?
Right, so here, yeah.
You get a lot of traffic making a right left turn.
Yeah, people trying to come out of Cottonwood and going east. Yeah, there's just a lot of traffic.
Oh, I have a question when you get to the...
Mr. Durant?
Yes, Ms. Piacana, mm-hmm. and this is also with Mr. Hagan. Ford does not go through to State Route 86 at this time. You know, it's been looked at as right in, right out over the years. Mm-hmm. Mr. Hagan, with it's in progress, the project to relinquish State Route 86, does that change that perspective? Because right now the traffic engineers can't look at that today. But do you think that has an impact in the future? Because that's within a few years.
So as you mentioned, Ford doesn't go through right here to Highway 86.
Mm-hmm.
And now that is definitely an impact as you pull out of the bank or out of the Farmer Boys restaurant. And if you can't make a left turn here, you're going to want to have Ford go through and go up there to make
so
a right.
So that, but that's all that's holding us back from that road being open is the state, am I correct?
That would take care of, if you eliminated the left turn coming out of Cottonwood, you definitely want to have Ford go through so people can
so
make
I think
a
this
right
is,
in, right out.
I bring this up because it's not a static project. We are, there's state legislation moving forward for the relinquishment. Raleigh's already done part of theirs. They want to get going on El Centro's, quite frankly, next. So I think by the time we hit this, Ms. Viacana, as we do our traffic study, we need to have that in play because it may take care of that issue.
Right.
That'd be a huge improvement for that area.
Yes,
to
it
be
would.
Able to go north on Cottonwood.
So I want to make sure we keep that on the table as we move forward, is that we go forward with the intention of the right in, right out that we've always wanted.
Yes.
Yeah, because otherwise, people that are leaving the bank or Applebee's...
That's a real problem.
If they can't make a left turn, they're going to have to cut across the...
Crookshank to Waterman.
So, clearly, this is going to take more work, but I think it's that the Ford Avenue one is not just a discussion item. It is one that is part of our circulation element, and that's all that holds us back, and we're in the middle of resolving that issue.
Okay. But the applicant that's coming forward now, even though his project is not really up and off the ground, this discussion that we're having could potentially make a difference for him, especially improve his circulation plan if, in fact, all of this come to reality, not knowing the timeline that he has envisioned for his project. Do we have... Okay. So whatever that timeline is, if that timeline... If we were to say back into that, with the projects that we're thinking about, 86, this would be a benefit for the applicant.
That's correct.
Yeah, okay.
Thomas?
Terry, do you think there's a chance that Caltrans would approve another connection on 86?
Mm-mm.
I believe so. I mean, it's I believe it's in our circulation.
Well, if I may, Caltrans won't while it's a state highway, but very shortly here, and when you talk about Caltrans within the next, I think, 2 years, Caltrans won't be a player in this discussion, and that's what changes the circumstances. Right now, Caltrans is trying to close all driveways they can. We went through the outpatient clinic. They were thrilled to see one more driveway removed. Clearly, it operates as an arterial, not as a state highway, and this is why I want to make sure that our staff keeps in mind as we go forward on this is one of the construction projects that we need to start looking at is how we bring that project online at the same time as this is resolved. And Caltrans has been pushing very hard for the El Central piece to happen next, and I think they actually may do, it won't be coming south, they'll start with the highest traffic points, and Raleigh was the first one to get done. Mm-hmm.
Mr. Okay. Tom Tepusis.
The public hearing is open.
Yes.
Good evening, Mayor Solomon, City Council members. My name is Tom Tepusis. I live at 367 South Haskell in El Centro, and I'm representing El Centro Motors, located, as we've indicated before, 1520 West Ford Drive, El Centro. I have prepared some comments. I just gave Diane a copy of it, and I want to just flip to this plan, which I'll show you in just a moment. El Centro Motors, as you know, has a long history in El Centro. It is the successor in interest to the Egger Brothers, which was the first corporation in El Centro. Matter of fact, it was the first corporation in Imperial County when it left San Diego and became Imperial County. It's an established Ford dealership, which came into business in 1956 and was the 138th automobile dealership in the state of California. Over the past 57 years, El Centro Motors has been selling and repairing vehicles in El Centro, employing individuals living in El Centro and areas surrounding El Centro. El Centro Motors has been a source of sales revenue, tax revenue for the city of El Centro. It has supported local charity entities ranging from local softball teams to national organizations, including the Boy Scouts of America. Not only has El Centro Motors been a part of the business fabric of El Centro, it has gone out of its way to help others in the community. For example, in 2002, the Imperial County Board of Supervisors awarded El Centro Motors a Workforce Investment Board contract in the amount of $387,454 to provide customized training program for 90 existing employees and 25 new hires in the phase one portion of the WIB training program. In early 2003, Workforce Investment Board funds to the county were dramatically cut. The Imperial County Workforce Investment Board had several other training programs that were about to be funded, but could not do so because of the funding cuts. El Centro Motors generously stepped up and returned the $387,454 to the WIB so that other companies could utilize these training funds. I think this demonstrates the character and the dedication to the community of El Centro Motors. Currently, El Centro Motors supports 80 households by employing persons living in El Centro and the surrounding areas. El Centro Motors purchases supplies and services from El Centro businesses. El Centro Motors continues to pay taxes and create tax revenue to the city of El Centro. ECM's business expansion plans include establishing another automobile dealership to be located on the property west of its current operation on West Ford Drive, down Waterman Avenue. I have a site plan which was prepared for this expansion. I'd like to show it to you. I don't have a copy of this, but I can make a copy if you like it. Let me see how much farther I can get away. Let me just pass it around if it's okay. This is West Ford Drive, this is Waterman. The intent is to create 50 new jobs and a projected vehicle sales and service revenue of $2,250,000 per month. Unfortunately, the downturn in the past economy caused El Centro Motors to postpone the expansion. However, it appears the economy is recovering, and this bodes well for the planned expansion. And what I'd like to do for the audience is to show where that would be. This is the current location of El Centro Motors right here. And the new dealership would be located right here, which is directly across the street from the vacant lot right here. So it'd occupy those basically three lots.
What's the, acreage there for the, you know, Mr. Tacuzas?
46.
I'm sorry?
Robert?
46.
40.
Oh, more than six.
More than 6 acres.
6 acres, okay.
That information is also contained in the package that's being circulated. El Centro Motors is supportive of better quality of life in El Centro, including the creation of new jobs and housing for families and individuals who live in El Centro. We have looked at the proposed general plan amendment and the change of zone from general commercial to multifamily residential for the property located down the street from our current operations and directly across the street from our proposed expansion area. El Centro Motors has also reviewed the immediate area surrounding the current general commercial zoned area, and there seems to be several areas which are currently zoned for residential use. Although we support multiple family housing with its high population density, we are opposed to this particular general plan amendment and the zoning change. The placing of a residential housing in a commercial area when there is ample existing residential zoned area outside of the commercial area raises several land use concerns. Safety is the first issue. With a higher population density, there will be a greater amount of traffic than currently planned. There is the everyday delivery of vehicle parts, dealership supplies, car carriers loading and unloading vehicles. This traffic is in addition to the customer traffic which occurs with the El Centro Motors dealership and the Quick Lane repair facility. Another issue not always addressed is crime. An automobile dealership has literally several millions of dollars of inventory on display at any given time. With a higher density residential population located across the street from the dealership, there is concerns of vandalism and theft. Just recently, matter of fact last week, the El Centro Police Department arrested an individual in the bathroom of the dealership who was trying to avoid law enforcement officials. Then there's the concern of residents' complaints about noise, which is always associated with the car dealership. There are daily vehicle repairs, including the use of air guns, vehicle lifts, vehicle washing equipment with high-powered blowers, safety testing of vehicle horns, testing of vehicle alarms, telephone intercom paging of individuals, and music played over the loudspeakers. Residents who have just finished working the night shift would come home to his or her apartment to a variety of dealership sounds. Residents swimming in a pool or children walking in the vicinity of the commercial business would be, be complaining about normal business noise. Individuals riding bicycles or pushing baby strollers in this commercial area would be concerned by El Centro Motors vehicle traffic. There is another concern, which is future development of this commercial area. With time, current vacant lots will be subject to development. With this commercial development, when this commercial development occurs, and I got a beautiful fly here, in the immediate vicinity, or will commercial developers elect not to make an investment in Northgate commercial area due to the risk that residential development brings with commercial area? What impact would a change in zoning have on the value of the land which has been purchased as commercial property? In light of the speaker's time restrictions, I can tell you these are just a few of the concerns of El Centro Motors. El Centro Motors asked that the developers place their high medium density residential development in an area that is better suited for this type of land use, such as a residentially zoned property, not located in the middle of a general commercial area. The potential legal liability risk for damage to individuals and properties will substantially increase with this residential development being located in a commercial area. You have a fiduciary duty to protect those who live and work in the city of El Centro. Please keep families and individuals residing in residential areas, not in the middle of commercial areas. Thank you. If you have any questions.
Mr. Mayor, I have a question. Mr. Tafousis, your hours of operation for El Centro Motors?
The quick lane opens, I believe it's at 7 o'clock.
And closing time?
And it closes at 9.
9 p.m. daily?
Except for Sundays. Mm-hmm. Correct.
We clarify that. If that's the sales part is open until 9?
Yeah, let me show you. The service center, the quick lane is this building right here. So you have traffic coming in here, and this is where some of that repair noise would be generated. And then this is the sales area and then repair area for the dealership in through here.
The hours of the repair area?
Robert? Let me introduce Robert Valdez. He's the general manager of El Centro Motors.
Thank you. Thank you for listening. The service department is open till 7 p.m. The sales department is open till 9, but during the summer hours, we usually are there till about midnight.
For sales.
Mm-hmm. There is a car wash standalone building that sits on. Okay. Right here, very close to the area in particular, that has high. Sounding blowers and the car will run through. It's a full integrated unit. That will be in use until midnight during the summer.
I have a question if the applicant would be interested in responding, and I don't want to put any pressure on you, but you obviously have had a track record of successful development here. You've heard the concerns of not quite an adjacent landowner, but if that other site was to be developed, it would be an adjacent landowner. So issues with regard to traffic and crime, although I'd note that the vandalism issue was something that occurred now, not when there's any housing in the area, but probably most significantly the noise.
Just a couple of things I'd like to point out. The one thing is we actually acquired this property from the city of El Centro in a land swap about 5 years ago. We own the property there on Bradshaw where the fire station is, and that was actually high density. At the time, the apartment market wasn't very strong. We saw a situation we could help the city out, so we swapped the property with the intention of one day trying to go back in and do a rezone general plan amendment on this property because I guess it wasn't suitable for the fire station. What we're seeing right now, we've got about 800 to 900 units under construction throughout California. The general trend is, you went through a period there where there was a suburban sprawl, people were moving in the country, they wanted the bigger house. We're now seeing that change where people are wanting to move back into the city, be within walking distance from groceries, their restaurants, the tanning salon, culture, museums, things like that. So people are giving up the acreage and they actually, they want to be closer to the amenities that are nearby. You know, we built many mixed-use projects like this, and yeah, there is going to be, it's a give and take thing. You're going to give up some of your privacy. There will be some noise complaints here and there, but it's not something that we really had a major problem with. And like I said, a majority of our projects now are going into this mixed-use type of developments. And I mean, there are, if you look on this property just to the north, there's plenty of apartments right there. I mean, I don't know that they have an issue with it. I think it's a really high-end market rate apartments on the other side of Trestle.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So it may seem like it's, you're going to be losing some commercial acreage there, but at the end of the day, what we see from retail tenants is they're looking for traffic and they're looking for rooftops. This project will it'll increase traffic, which is good for retail tenants. If you're looking for more commercial growth, more sales tax revenue, that's going to help in the long run. Because we're going to build probably 100 to 110 units there. We're probably going to build it in phases. We're working on a site plan right now, which will allow us to maybe build 50 to 60 units at once, and then once that's leased up, then build the second project. So we're not looking at just throwing 100 units right in the market at once. We're going to slow ease into it as the project leases up. So that's kind of our game plan.
Thank you. I will say that I sit on the Southern California Association of Governments, which is the planning arm for the 6 Southern California counties, not including San Diego. We study a lot of regional housing needs and do a lot of assessments with regard to what the trends are. Every study that I've read in the last several years indicates that this type of mixed use with commercial and multifamily is absolutely the wave of the future. People want to get out of their cars. They want access, walking access to amenities. They want to be able to walk to the bank, walk to the restaurant, walk to shopping. We talk about redeveloping downtown, and how do we propose to do that? By opening storefronts on the bottom and housing up above. When we approved the mall, it was a mixed use. It was all of the mall, plus there was going to be adjacent housing was part of that master plan. So in my mind, this is absolutely the type of project that we're going to see more and more of, because it's going to be what people are asking for. They do want to get out of their single family homes. And we've not had an apartment complex built in the city of El Centro in a number of years. I think there's a big, big demand for this type of housing option. People want to also be close to transportation, to the extent they can grab a bus or something else in that area. I think that that's another reason why they would want to occupy that an apartment in that area. So, Mr. Tapuzas, I respectfully, I have a lot of respect for you, and I understand the points that you've raised, but I really do see that this could be a good fit for both.
Yeah, I agree with you in regards to sustainability. If you take a look at some of the projects, let's say in San Diego in the Hillcrest area, where the Sears used to be located, where you have retail below, Trader Joe's, grocery stores, and then above that you have housing. That's in a residential area, and it works out very well. What we have here is a lot that's in a commercial area, and I think that type of discussion that you had about retail on the bottom and residential on top is a little bit different than this location here. I'm very supportive of the greenhouse gas initiatives to reduce that, sustainability. I have two clients who are developing 10,000 dwelling units in the north area, so I'm very, very familiar with that, and I endorse that as you do. Like I said, I think, and I do not know the builder, but I have no malice towards the builder. The builder is not the issue. The quality of what they do is not the issue. The need for senior housing is not the issue. The issue is that this is just in the wrong location.
Got two competing views here.
Well,
if I may, Mr. Silver, please. I can appreciate both of you, but certainly when you talk about the fact that El Centro Motors is taxpayers, and certainly sales tax is very important for us. But also property tax is important for us as well. So when we try to weigh that, the property tax is important and so are housing needs. I understand your concern about the location may be inappropriate or not suitable because of where it's located. But as I look to what's going on Tress Hill in the city of Imperial, that's that huge complex right there, which I think is in the neighborhood. I call it in the same neighborhood, mm-hmm. even though it's in a neighboring city. So I envision that Al Centro Motors and a project of this nature could become good neighbors. I really do.
Well, what we did with the housing projects for Brookfield Homes and for the 101 Ranch is there was concern about Holly Sugar Plant and odors that would come out of Holly Sugar and farming in the area, mm-hmm. including a feedlot located at the southern boundary of the 101 Ranch. And the developers agreed to put in a provision prohibiting the purchasers of the homes from suing those businesses. And that was a very effective compromise to allow the project to go forward and yet preserve those entities that had been there in the past. And there may be opportunities like that, including, as Ruben Durant had mentioned, El Centro Motors is one of the co-developers of this project. Mm-hmm. And this right here, the Ford Drive, originally that was going to go on to Caltrans, but we all know how Caltrans is, and it's just impossible to have that planned improvement made while Caltrans has the jurisdiction over it. So there may be opportunities where the developer can work with us and we can work with the developer. My concern is that I don't particularly want to see El Centro Motors get sued by these residents. I'm really concerned about the potential of safety. I don't know what the traffic study did, if they included the number of test drives that go on around there, if they included the fact that car carriers unload vehicles there all the time. I really don't know. I haven't seen the traffic study. But as Norma had mentioned, that should this go forward and a development come into play, mm-hmm. the specifics of that development will be examined and there will be opportunities to discuss it.
Absolutely.
And should that be the case, we'll be very anxious to take a look at it and comment on it.
Okay. We had a similar project, certainly to the north of the city when we put in the what we call the travel center, or some people refer to it as a truck stop.
Yes.
As you notice, look at how much development is around there.
Yes.
And the trucks are going, and people thought we didn't want that diesel, we didn't want that noise. And yet, that particular neighborhood seems to be flourishing with not only apartment complex, In-N-Out Burger, Subway, and for a time, Millie's. And that all mm-hmm. seemed to work. So that's why I believe, that this is an opportunity for good neighbors to really find something that can be harmonious as far as the development is concerned.
Yeah, again, our greatest fear is increased legal liability.
Okay.
Well, I do have, and I did ask a question prior to Mr. Zapusa's coming, because I did felt somewhat uncomfortable about an island, a residential island mm-hmm. surrounded by general commercial designation and the potential impact of that on the commercial areas. I'm not so convinced that potential impacts such as traffic, noise, have been addressed through the negative declaration. I have a concern not knowing what kind of residential development we'll have there. The safety of children walking from that location to the closest school, which would be King Elementary?
I believe so,
would be the closest school. And I don't know that that bus transportation will be provided to those children, potentially, if it's a normal multi-complex project. I do have some concerns over the ramifications of that residential project on other general commercial areas around, and whether that would in fact deter the kind of commercial development that we have seen in, on that property. So I share Mr. Tupusa's concerns, and I share that prior to him addressing the council. So I do tend to agree that this is not the the proper location for this project.
Anyone else?
Does the other gentleman want to come back?
Yes.
One comment real quick. This project, we've never actually sold a project. Every project we built, we own, and we'll continue to own. They will be for rent, so everybody will continue to own the project. There will be tenants. They will be signing lease agreements. We can work with Ford Motors on putting some type of provision in the lease agreement stating that there will be these activities going on nearby, just to protect them liability-wise. I mean, we're open to these discussions with our neighbors. Yeah, and it protects us, exactly. So when that, our goal is to protect ourselves, his goal is to protect himself. So, I mean, we can work together on that if that's an issue, if there are liability concerns. So.
Well, I'm one that's for mixed use. I've said I would like to see it downtown. I would like to see it any place we can get it in El Centro. And if that's an opportunity for us to have it, I certainly would like to be able to try it. But I agree with Mr. Silva and Mr. Sanders that we want to make sure that those kids are not in positions of getting hurt.
Exactly.
And wind up being suing someone. Mm-hmm. So for that reason, not yet. That is the ultimate problem. But for right now, I would like for us to continue down this road and see if we can't put the pieces together to make this happen. Okay. Thank you.
Is there another public comment slip? Or
so there's nothing else for this. Maybe there's other public comments.
Could I retrieve my plan, please?
I'm sorry? Oh, absolutely.
Maybe there's other members who want to speak to this on either side of the issue.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Can I make one more?
Sure.
Diane, did you get his name?
And I am Robert Valdez, general manager of El Centro Motors. When this area here got built and people started moving in, there's a rental apartment. There is a huge canal here, which is a much bigger distance between the two properties. However, a lot of people walk over to Walmart, like you said, and since they don't like making this big, long deal, the only way to cross is right here. This is a huge canal. They walk right through our lot with little kids, with strollers, right through the middle of the car dealership, day and nighttime, to cross right here and then walk over to their particular households. We've had, police officers chase them and take them out of our bathrooms. We've had vandalism along the way. We've had salespeople almost run kids over because they can't see them. Our lot is a one-way in only, and yet somebody shows up out of the middle of a car. It is dangerous. And there is a huge liability in having customers that are not there to do business with you being crossing on a consistent basis. This would do the same thing. This would just have a lot of people in the lot. And mechanics test drive cars back here. Trucks unload behind Foot City all day long. This is a heavy, heavy traffic area for trucks, cars, test driving, etc. This corner doesn't stop all day long. These kids would be in huge danger crossing that street or even walking down the street. Just my comments.
Okay.
Is there anyone else from the public who want to make a statement on this issue? If not, we're going to bring it back to the city council. We're closing the public hearing.
If the public hearing is closed, I would like to make a motion to approve resolution number 13-45, Resolution of the City Council of City of El Centro approving General Plan Amendment Number 12-03 to change the land use designation from general commercial to high medium density residential usage for a 4.33 acre parcel of vacant land located on the northeast corner of Waterman Avenue and Cruikshank Drive, further identified by APN 064-442-001, and declaring same to be the third general plan amendment for calendar year 2013.
Second.
We have a motion by Ms. Walker, a second by Mrs. Sanders. Please vote.
Motion carries 3 in favor and 1 against and 1 absent.
And I think is this project, to Mr. Mayor, now that this, are you ready to go with, okay, thank you.
I'd like to move approval of resolution number 13-46, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro adopting negative declaration number 12-05A without monitoring plan for GPA number 12-03.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Walker, second by Ms. Sanders. Please vote.
Motion carries.
I'd like to move approval of resolution number 13-47, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro adopting negative declaration number 12-05B without monitoring plan for COZ number 12-03.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Walker, second by Ms. Sanders. Please vote.
Motion carries 3 with 1 no.
Approval of ordinance number 13-24. An ordinance of the City Council of City of El Centro amending the zoning map of the City of El Centro pertaining to approved zone change of zone number 12-03.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Walker, second by Mrs. Sanders. Please vote.
The motion carries 3 with 1 no.
Mr. Mayor, of course this project is still in the very formative stage. So as we move down the pipeline with it, I'm sure that all of these comments that were heard from both sides of the discussion, and certainly those comments from the council member, will be taken into consideration. And the planning commissioners will be well aware of that. Okay, thank you.
Up under new business, discussion on any necessary action regarding CRNR's request for an annual rate adjustment for solid waste and recycling. Mr. Terry Hagan.
Thank you, Mayor and Council members. I'll first review the contract services that we have with CRNR. We have the residential three-cart system for trash, recyclables, and green waste. We have quarterly drop-off events for the residents. We have three bulky item collections, just with the residents calling up and requesting the pickup at the curbside. We have curbside used oil collection for those that change their oil. Discarded item collection in downtown alleys. We have street sweeping services as well. We have disposal of waste at the CRNR facility by residents on East Main at the CRNR site. If you fill up your trash can and you need more room, you can go drop it off there at their site. Annual compost giveaway event to educate the benefits of green waste recycling. Collection of the city facilities free of charge. And collection of waste and recyclables from city-sponsored events. This contract was first set up March 20th, 2007. The new contract for residential rate, the monthly rate, was $15.99 per month. And HF&H, a consulting firm that's assisted us in the original contract, still assists us to review all the rate change or rate adjustments annually as they come in. And so they assisted us in the original contract and the bid process. The first rate increase took effect in 2008, $16.87. The next one, second one, occurred 2010 at $17.61. Then in 2011, we added street sweeping services at no extra cost by extending the contract, and the rate change was to $18.31. Then in 2012, we had a rate reduction, the fourth rate adjustment, to $18.15. Again, this is the monthly rate for residential services. Then on February 26, 2013, we got the fifth request for a rate adjustment. HF&H, our consultant, reviewed that rate adjustment, and they concurred with the calculations and the adjustment request. There is also, at a later date, I'll come back in a few months with some small changes, minor changes to the contract as well. And that's dealing with transfer disposal CPI instead of landfill gate rates being used, and prepayment and refunds for the roll-off customers that are non-credit. Indemnification for Prop 218, CR&R has done this in the past, they're doing this again this year. The rate adjustment analysis depends on these published priced indices. Fuel, equipment, labor, disposal, insurance, and all the others are grouped into another category. The rate adjustment request by CR&R was for the cart and bin services, 1.7%, roll-off box service, 1.5%, and then the roll-off box disposal, or the tipping fee, 1.9%. And HF&H reviewed and concurred with those. This shows the different rate tables. The next several slides cover these changes. You can see we've gone on a residential rate. We've gone from 1815 to 1846, a 31-cent increase in the monthly rate. Here are the other rates as well. We have Dean and Dan from CR&R tonight, if there's any questions directly for them, or I can answer questions now if you have any.
The rates would go into effect when, Mr. Hagan?
The rates will go into effect when? That was the question.
July 1st, I'm sorry.
July 1st, okay.
Terry, my difficulty with this a year ago was that, I think it was a year ago, maybe 2 years, I don't know, remember. But CR&R had submitted a proposal to the City of Hopewell to provide trash services, and what they were charging the City of Hopewell was less than what they were charging us.
That's correct.
And my difficulty with that is that it didn't make sense that a very small community would receive lower fees than a bigger city where you have economies of scale.
And I do have those rates okay. Here for
so how does that
residential.
Compare now?
Except for Hopewell, we are the lowest in the county, lowest rate for the residential service. And I believe CR&R explained this as an incremental increase in their service to a neighboring city, and that's how they bid and won this particular contract with Hopewell. And they're here to further explain that if you'd
can
like.
Can you explain that again, Dean, for me? Because I don't remember the answer. Why does Hopewell get such a favorable rate as compared to us?
I'm not doing street sweeping.
Good evening, Mayor Solomon, members of the council. It's a pleasure to be here and see you again this year. Again, Dan Drewick is with me, your general manager. And first of all, I'd like to say that we agree with the staff recommendation. We follow the methodology specifically in the franchise agreement, and it's been verified, obviously, by your consultant and your staff. The question, I guess, Mr. Silva, is why has Hopewell got a lower rate than El Centro? And You know, I get the same question, and we got the same question in Heber a couple weeks ago. Their rate adjustment is in October, as well as Westmoreland and so forth. So your rate, the Holtville rate, that 1561, is the new rate. It was approved today by staff in Holtville. It is a good rate. Competition creates a different rate structures. As when Holtville did decide to go out for RFP, they were, as you know, unhappy with their current hauler. They had the highest rate in the county. They were, I think, like $23. And they were looking to try to save their citizens as much money as they could. When we looked at Holtville being a small community, we looked at it as we didn't have to add any trucks. We didn't have to add anything to our facilities. And we had a workforce that was large enough at the time to handle it. So we looked at it as, like Mr. Hagan said, as an incremental cost to us. And we gave them a, kind of, if I excuse the term, we gave them a smoking deal.
Mm-hmm.
A smoking deal. So does that answer your question, Mr. Silva?
Yeah, it does. But
does it also, Mr. Ruffage, include Are you sweeping their streets as well?
Yes, we have. In fact, since Holtville and El Centro a couple of years ago, we've added street sweeping to most of our communities here in Imperial County, because most of the communities, if they have a sweeper, they don't have personnel to drive it, and if they have a contract with the county, it's not being done. So we've offered that to most of our communities. In fact, Heber, I believe, Dan will be in front of them on this Thursday evening. And they're really serious about taking or giving street sweeping to CR&R and having the county reimburse them for it, because that is an unincorporated area. So we're trying to provide that service in most all of our communities in Imperial County.
Of the cities that are, Mr. Mayor, if I may continue, of the cities listed there, El Centro and Holtville, which other cities? Heber? Which are the other cities?
That have street sweeping?
Well, that have you providing service.
All of these are provided by CR&R.
Which one have the streets sweeping?
Street sweeping is the only area we do not provide street sweeping as of yet is Heber.
Okay. Thank you.
Is there anyone else?
I would like to say that I've been very pleased with the service provided by CR&R personally, but probably a bigger deal for me is the fact I don't get any complaints from residents, and that speaks volumes to me, because this used to be a much different situation. I think CR&R has been a very good partner with us. I appreciate the street sweeping. I think that was a pretty seamless transition from the city providing that service to CR&R. With those comments, I would move for approval of resolution number 13-48, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro conditionally rescinding resolution number 12-97 and reestablishing rates for the collection, transportation, recycling, processing, and disposal of solid waste.
Second.
We have a motion by Mrs. Walker, a second by Mrs. Sanders. Please vote.
Sorry. Motion carries 4-0.
Mayor, before you go on, I just not your vote. A little footnote to an action that you took several years ago on the street sweeping. This last month, Caltrans had notified the cities that were still doing street sweeping that were waiting for grants to pay for their natural gas street sweepers. They're not going to get those street sweepers because the federal government is now required to Build America, and there are no American-built CNG street sweepers. They don't exist. So all the cities that are still sweeping, they have nowhere to go. And so this has really caused a real concern, except for those cities that have contractors handling that. So the good news is we're not scrambling to figure out all of a sudden how to pay for street sweepers where the CNG. Now, we still get our funding for those programs. We use them in other areas. But I wanted to share is that it's been a real concern for the other cities that are, we're counting on those grants, and it has to do with a change in the Build America program. So sometimes you're just lucky.
Okay. Discussion and any necessary action regarding the submittal of an application to the California State Department of Housing and Community Development for funding under the Home Investment Partnership Program. Marcelo Piedra.
Yes, good evening, Honorable Mayor, members of the council. Very pleased to present to you this resolution for your consideration tonight. It basically is a resolution allowing city staff to proceed with the preparation of a grant application under the state's home program. And basically the purpose of this application is to fulfill a much needed need, which actually was previously discussed as a result of this rezone that was done. We have a proposal, and we've been approached by Chelsea Investment Corporation and also the Imperial Valley Housing Authority to consider a $4.6 million grant application to HOME to construct senior units on a property located at 1725 Adams Avenue. And the staff report includes some pictures of the site. This particular 2-acre site was formerly used as a trailer park, and it hasn't been obviously used for those reasons for many years. And so now, in partnership with with Chelsea Investment Corporation and the Imperial Valley Housing Authority, they've approached the city about the possibility of submitting this application to the state. In many aspects, this is a very beneficial project to the city. Obviously, we're taking an infill lot and providing housing. It's along Adams Avenue where, as a matter of fact, Chelsea owns 72 family apartment complex, and also the Housing Authority owns several housing units along Adams Avenue. At the time when the staff report was prepared, we were considering 56 units. However, Chelsea has just completed a site plan review with our community development department, and the number of units has been reduced to 54 in order to allow the proper parking to be included in the project. Your resolution does reflect 56 units, but we will make the revision to include 54. The project is a $10 million project, and basically the type of mix of units that we will have is 44 one-bedroom units and 12 two-bedroom units. The rents will be approximately $300 to $700 per month. This application is due to the state on July 8th. Therefore, we have a very short time frame to put it together and get the necessary information to submit it to the state. The units will be restricted for 55 years for our seniors. And we're, again, very happy to have this proposal come before us. We have very experienced entities proposing this project, so we feel pretty comfortable working with them in submitting this application. And we do have representation from Chelsea, and we do have also a representative from the Imperial Valley Housing Authority in case you have any questions related to this project.
Thank you, Ms. Piedra. I have a question with regard to the site plan. I don't see a swimming pool. I see a community building, but no swimming pool. I would think that would be an amenity that our seniors might like. No?
Good evening. I just want to take this opportunity to thank you for allowing us to allowing me to speak for a minute in support of this project. I've been working, I had this site under option for a couple of years, looking for a financing mechanism, and 2 or 3 months ago I had a conversation with Jim Schmidt from Chelsea, and he's like, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm having trouble financing. He says, well, let's do a tax credit thing. Well, we haven't done tax credits since we did the first one with him that he did in the early 90s, and we kind of shy away from, but there's been other means for us to use to finance, and those have kind of all dried up. So we are glad to be working with Chelsea. And as you know, these projects require multiple funding levels. We're really happy, and we've been talking about this with the city probably for 2 years about, you know, can we come in with a home app and do this? We've always been looking at an elderly project. There's several other family projects in the area, so we want to see an elderly project go in there, kind of mix up the mix a little bit. And anyway, we're real happy that this thing is finally moving along after a couple of years of thinking and talking about it. So we really appreciate your support on this. And I don't think there's going to be a swimming pool there. So if you have any other questions.
Is that just because it's an amenity that the seniors aren't interested in having there?
Exactly. Bob Cummings with Chelsea. Typically for our seniors projects, we don't put pools in. And even in the Las Brisas 72 units that we just built on 8th, we didn't put a pool feature in us either.
That landscaping, have you looked at the landscaping?
Well, it's xeriscape. I mean, it's...
No, but some of the palm trees look like...
We're looking at replacing those.
Okay. Yes. But it's a beautiful, beautiful complex. I'm assuming fully rented from like the day you opened?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Moved area in 4 days.
It's amazing.
I wanted to say one other thing that we have... We maintain a waiting list. We have over 6,000 people on our, we call our combined list, and we haven't taken applications in 2 years. Normally it runs to between 8,000 and 9,000. I do letters to the tax credit, all the tax credit investors, they want to know what the market is down here. Well, we all know that there's a great need for affordable housing, and I think we submitted our numbers, our current numbers with the application, and doesn't seem like a lot. Well, 6,000 is a lot, but I mean, we've been way higher than that in the past, but we haven't taken applications in a couple of years. So just something I wanted to, you know, let you know. There's a definite need for this project, and we feel it's a very good project, and we have a very great chance of getting this thing put together with your help.
Mr. Mayor, I don't know, Marcella or for Chelsea, but is this a competitive grant, or is it... What's the process on the state reviewing and ultimately approving this?
The state issued its notice of funding availability on May 1st, and it was a very short time frame to go to the training workshop and really put together the application because it was just released. Obviously, the home program has seen major cuts. I mean, when we applied for the Las Brisas project, they were offering almost $60 million. Right now, they only have $28 million. I had a chance to attend the training workshop in Sacramento, and yes, it's going to be very, very competitive for us because with the loss of redevelopment agency, I mean, we had a room packed of people, and we have to really put together a very, very competitive application. The benefit for us has been that, one, we're working with experienced developers. The city also is in good standing in terms of performance with our projects. So it's based on points, and we're looking very closely at the points and how we score in terms of community. I mean, there's various factors that are taken into consideration, but I wish that it wasn't competitive, but it is. The state believes that they're probably going to be funding anywhere from 6 to maybe 7 projects statewide. Mm-hmm. But we're very, you know, feel very positive about it, and we're going to go after the grant funds and hope that our application scores high.
Thank you,
Mr. Mayor, I have a question. Of those 6,000 people on your waiting list, are they countywide? Is that countywide?
That's correct. We call it our combined list. Okay. However, the greatest number of them want to live in the city of El Centro because of the abundance of services. And those are also, that's everybody. And so out of that, we have about 800 seniors on that list, and this is, we're talking about a seniors project. I think they have an application process. Chelsea has an app, or you know, they keep numbers, and I don't know, their numbers were, they had a couple hundred on, or was it 500 on their list also? So they have a, you know, for their existing projects, you track that kind of information. So when we're doing things like this, it's like, okay, what do we need to build? And, you know, so we haven't built an elderly project or an affordable seniors project, we call them, and since we built the ones on Adam and Holt Street, which we call Cedar, and so we're looking to, you know, fill that void that we haven't filled in.
Okay.
This wasn't a public hearing.
No.
Okay.
I would like to move approval of resolution number 13-49, a resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro approving the submittal of an application to the California State Department of Housing and Community Development for funding under the Home Investment Partnerships Program, and if selected, approving the execution of a standard agreement and amendment thereto, and of any related documents necessary to participate in the Home Investment Partnerships Program.
Second.
We have a motion by Mrs. Walker, second by Mr. Silva and Mrs. Sanders. Please vote.
Motion carries 4-0.
Thank you very much.
Thank
you.
Okay.
Good luck.
Discussion and any necessary action regarding the appointment of three members of the El Centro Library Board of Trustees with terms ending in June 30, 2016. We're going to keep the three that were on it. They asked to be reconsidered and they've been placed back on. It's Thomas Barrington, Judith
Barrington,
and Judith Ashman, and Douglas R. Newland.
I move for the mayor's recommendation.
Second.
We have a motion by Mr. Silver, second by Ms. Sanders.
Motion carries.
We have an item.
At this time, we'd like to take action on an item or several items coming out of closed session. This would be the approval of a number of resolutions of employment-related agreements. For purposes of the minutes, do I need to read each of the resolution titles? Okay. Can we take them all as one item?
No, they each need separate resolution numbers.
Right, but I mean, can we vote on them collectively or after each?
After each.
After each, okay. So the first would be resolution number 13-50.
Correct.
Yes?
Yes.
Resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro identifying, recognizing, and establishing terms and conditions of employment for unrepresented police management employees.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Walker, second by Mr. Silva. Please vote.
The motion carries.
Resolution number 13-51, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro identifying, recognizing, and establishing terms and conditions of employment for unrepresented fire safety management employees.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Walker, second by Mr. Silva. Please vote.
No motion carries.
Resolution number 13-52, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro identifying, recognizing, and establishing the terms and conditions of employment for unrepresented confidential employees.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Walker, second by Mr. Silva. Please vote.
That motion carries 4-0.
Resolution number 13-53, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro identifying, recognizing, and establishing terms and conditions of employment for unrepresented management employees.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Walker, second by Mr. Silver. Please vote.
That motion carries 4-0.
Move for approval of resolution number 13-54. Resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro establishing the compensation and employment terms for the position of City Attorney.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Silva, second by Ms. Walker.
Motion to approve resolution.
Set.
Too fast.
I have a no. Is that?
No, sorry.
Okay.
Sorry, Chris. Revalid, please.
Motion carries 4-0.
Move to approve resolution 13-55, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro establishing the terms and employment terms for the position of City Clerk.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Silva, second by Mrs. Walker. Please vote.
The motion carries 4-0.
Motion to approve resolution number 13-56, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro establishing the compensation and employment terms for the position of City Manager.
Second.
We have a motion by Mr. Silva, a second by Mrs. Walker. Please vote.
Motion carries 4-0.
Motion to approve resolution number 13-57, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro establishing the compensation and employment terms for the position of Community Development Director.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Silver, second by Ms. Walker. Please vote.
The motion carries 4-0.
Motion to approve resolution number 13-58, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro establishing the compensation and employment terms for the position of Director of Economic Development.
Second.
Motion by Ms. Mrs. Silver, second by Ms. Walker. Please vote.
The motion carries 4-0.
Motion to approve resolution number 13-59, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro establishing the compensation and employment terms for the position of Director of Finance.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Silva, second by Ms. Walker. Please vote.
Motion carries 4-0.
Motion to approve resolution number 13-60, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro establishing the compensation and employment terms for the position of Director of Human Resources.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Silva, second by Ms. Walker. Please vote.
That motion carries 4-0.
Motion to approve resolution number 13-61, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro establishing the compensation and employment terms for the position of Library Director.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Silva, second by Ms. Walker. Please vote.
That motion carries 4-0.
Resolution number 13-62, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro establishing the compensation and employment terms for the position of Director of Parks and Recreation.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Silva, second by Ms. Walker. Please vote.
The motion carries 4-0.
Motion to approve resolution number 13-63, resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro establishing the compensation and employment terms for the position of Chief of Police.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Silva, second by Ms. Walker. Please vote.
And finally, motion to approve.
Was that in favor, Mr. Solomon?
Pardon?
I have a no on that.
No.
Oops, so did you vote against?
Reballot.
Reballot, please.
Is that the Chief of Police?
No, that was Terry.
Oh, Terry.
Chief of Police.
Oh, it's Chief of Police? Okay.
The motion carries 4-0.
Motion to approve resolution number 13-64, establishing the City Council. Resolution of the City Council of the City of El Centro establishing the compensation for the Director of Public Works, City Engineer.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Silva, second by Ms. Walker. Please vote.
The motion carries.
Well done by the team on the end.
We do have a potential added item which has to do with the number of support or opposed letters as requested by the League of California Cities. Is it appropriate at this time, Ms. Becker, to add this item?
Yes, if the need for action arose after the agenda was posted, then you can make a motion to add.
I'd like to make that motion to add this agenda item then.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Walker and second by Mrs. Sanders. Please vote.
Motion carries.
It would be my recommendation that for those bills that have a hearing date, that have been assigned a hearing date, that we follow the League of California Cities recommendation. So my motion would be to send an opposed letter for AB 562, which has a hearing date of June 26th, an opposed letter to AB 667, which will be heard in the Senate Governance and Finance Committee on June 26th. Oppose SB 439, which will be heard in the Assembly Public Safety Committee on June 28th. That would be an opposed position on medical marijuana enforcement. And a support position on SB 56, Incorporations and Annexations. That bill will be heard by the Senate Governance and Finance Committee on June 19th. That's SB 56, a support position.
Second.
I have a motion by Ms. Walker, second by Mrs. Silva. Please vote.
The motion carries 4-0.
I'd like to thank Ms. Connor for turning this agenda item around so very, very quickly. I think we were just notified by the League with regard to the particular support and opposed position. So very much appreciate your timely preparation of this item.
Discussion and any necessary action regarding the City Council who are on dark for the month of August.
I think that there was just the one item, potential item, that we could do an afternoon meeting, and so I would support us going dark if that city manager concurs with that recommendation.
Yes, and this way we started working on this several months ago. That's why some things have been accelerated. Nothing's being delayed. We just pushed everything through quicker and to allow for August to be completely dark.
So could we take action for the City Council to direct the City Clerk to take the action necessary for Council to go dark the month of August 2013, except on an as-needed basis if we need to meet?
But we are scheduling a noon meeting.
The specific date will be determined on the bid documents ready from the paving project. So it may not be the 6th. It could be in July. Or it could be later on, but by August 15th, we have to have this awarded. Am I correct on that, Mr. Higgins? That's our late date.
Is that a motion, Ms. Walker?
Yes.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Walker, second by Mrs. Sanders. Please vote.
The motion carries 4-0.
Okay. The City Council, this is public comments. The City Council welcomes your input. At this time, members of the public may address the City Council on any matters not listed on the posted agenda. Pursuant to the Brown Act, no action will be taken on any issues brought forth under public comments. Please complete a speaker slip and submit it to the City Clerk prior to the start of the meeting. Unless the mayor extends the time, there's a 3-minute time limit for each public presentation. Is there anyone that would like to come up and speak during the public comments?
You want me to take notes so we can publish it in the paper tomorrow?
No. Hi, Alejandro. Your reporter for this is my last City Council meeting. I'll be moving to New York in August 1st. I got into Columbia University for journalism master's. Really, I just want to take the time to say really thank you, and it's been great working with you guys. It's been an excellent experience. I love this council. I've always bragged them about you guys. So hopefully you like the thing, the way I reported, and I came as fair, and I worked a lot, and that's about it. Thank you so much.
Where will you be going?
New York, Columbia University.
Columbia University, okay. So there's a big contingent of El Centro young folks living in New York. My daughter-in-law is actually at Columbia, so you're going to have like a ready-made circle of friends. We'll get all that information to you before you leave.
It should be fun. Thank you so much. And again, thank you so much for the opportunity.
Congratulations.
Good luck.
That's very awesome. Cool.
Wow.
Very, very cool.
That was a little different public comments, but it was enjoyable. Okay, the mayor and council members, we don't need a recess. Mayor and council members report.
I don't have a report.
I don't see Christy here, but I wanted to just congratulate her on the splash pad opening. That was a really, really great event to get that all up and running. And the incubator open house.
Oh, wonderful.
Oh, my gosh. Our regional president from the bank had the opportunity to attend and came back. And you would think that Deborah just walked on water the way he was talking about her and the program. Very, very, very favorably impressed. So I did pass along that information to Deborah and wanted to take this opportunity to do that again. Mr. Banks, your summer reading program, the materials for that are awesome. Wish you a lot of success with all of the reading programs that you have at the library. Are these posted on our website? Or the
website and our Facebook. Yes, they're both places.
Awesome. Great. Congratulations.
Ms. Sanders?
Nothing.
I've had a chance to speak at a couple of schools, and I mentioned to them the fact that this summer, the city is serving free breakfast and lunches for kids.
Nice.
And wherever I said that at, they were just thrilled. And I told them that you could get it at the El Centro Community Center. You can pick it up a meal at the library. And I can't remember where the third one was. It was at a school.
Oh, because the Methodist Church is also providing meals.
I also wanted to mention to you that I did a 1 minute
Methodist
blurb for the chamber, which they're going to use at their chamber dinner on the 20th, I think it is. We had a fireball conference today talking about how the city is involved with the chamber in providing a service, an actual opportunity for us to get a chance to see a lot of great looking cars come into the Imperial Valley. And the car buff, that's going to be just out of this world. And I did a 1 minute video for a fireball run. It won't be on your local TV, it won't be on national TV, but if I get a copy, I'll make sure you get a chance to see it. Well, you gotta have some fun sometime. Well, there is nothing else.
We're adjourned.
We're adjourned.
Great job.
That's how.
Great job.